And now it is my pleasure to introduce the author whose book you will soon buy, Kelli Jo Ford. Thank you so, so much for joining us from Richmond, I believe I saw, if I recall correctly. We're so glad you're here. And do you have a copy of your book handy?
I do.
Could you just read two or three paragraphs, just enough to give a taste to someone who hasn't read your work yet, what they might expect from reading your book?
Yeah, I'd love to. Thank you so much. So I'm going to read two paragraphs. They're longer paragraphs toward the end of the book. I don't know. I was going to tell you the title, but I'll just jump in. I don't think there's anything holding him to this earth anymore with his daddy gone. I saw him standing in the pasture watching the horses work around bale before I left. A gust of wind came that whipped up a cloud of dust and hay and grasshoppers so thick I lost pitch. After it settled some, the horses were running wild around the fence line, but Pitch was standing there with his arms out like he was waiting to be carried away. When it passed and the horses wandered back up, I could see Pitch's shoulders droop from the kitchen window. He hung his head and shuffled his way to the barn. I tell him to get over it. Buck up. This is the way of things. Kids grow up. We either end up just like our parents or do our best to turn out nothing like them. If we are lucky, we, by God, make a little better of all the things we can. Short of some terrible interruption, parents go first. That's the way of things. Of course, we work ourselves stiff in the meantime and cry ourselves dry, but maybe we get to have some little something that fills us up in our time. Our mamas and daddies, we don't have long to get over the loss or celebrate the release, as the case may be. Or our time here will be gone too, and our own kids will be burying us. I told him some version of this for about the 400th time before I left, and he stared through me like I was a piece of hay blowing in the wind. Rini says it hasn't been very long, and I need to let him work through it, that he's depressed. To that I say, who the fuck ain't? Thought I would start us off with something light and cheerful and really get us going here.
Absolutely. And just in your own words, real quick, the rundown, who are you as a person, as a writer?
Sure. I am a citizen of the Cherokee Nation. I grew up in the Cherokee Nation when I was a little girl, much like Rini in the book. And then I moved to North Texas. So I'm both a citizen of the Cherokee Nation and an Okie and a Texan, which is an interesting sort of crossroads to sit at and live as. I'm a mom. I have a little kid who's doing school fully virtual right now, which is making life and work very interesting. That's who I am, I guess. I went to George Mason in grad school. I went to Loyola in undergrad, as you did, which I hope to hear more about. But I've kind of always been writing, I guess. But it took me a long time to really realize that I was writing this book. I published my first book, Crooked Hallelujah, at 45. So I'm kind of I was a non-traditional student. First person in my family to graduate from college, and I went back to school at Loyola as like 25 and married. And so I'm kind of like maybe a non-traditional, short story writer, novelist, somewhere in between as well, maybe.
Yeah, so we share an alma mater, which mm-hmm. That was some deep internet digging, by the way. That did not pop up first thing. I was just like, about this guest author. And so I chose my happy hour beverage was, well, Texas connection with Shiner, but also this was the fancy beer we drank in college because it was on tap at all the bars in New Orleans before it was sort of nationally distributed. And it was the fancy beer because it was a little bit nicer than the Bud Light we usually got. So a Loyola memory from my time in New Orleans. So I did want to talk a little bit, you mentioned this a little bit, was your publishing journey. Mm-hmm. Usually I save these questions for last in case we have time, but I thought you might have an interesting one and also might be revealing to people who maybe haven't followed the supposedly linear path of student to grad student to author to published author. So let's start with the story of the book. How did it go from an idea to a physical object?
Sure. You know, I'd kind of forgotten this, but I'm going to speak to community college fiction workshop, which is very cool if community colleges are still teaching fiction workshops in this era and budget. But anyway, a really sweet student emailed me because he's going to introduce me and was asking some things that like weren't on the book flap necessarily. And I told him that I was a non-traditional student and I had, you know, I'd gone to Loyola and that my thesis there was titled Bonita. And that was a long time ago. And you know, none of those stories come in Crooked Hallelujah come from Bonita, but as soon like my very first story that I ever wrote in an intro to creative writing fiction workshop took place in this town that I decided to call it Bonita and was kind of just about the people and places that I come from. And that was really a revelation to me. I'd kind of been writing like tortured poetry and journals all my life. And I took this intro to fiction workshop and I just kind of landed on writing, realizing it was like a new realization that I could write where I came from. And that's kind of what I've always been doing. I kind of wandered around and found my way into an MFA program. And in that MFA program at Mason, George Mason in Fairfax, I was really kind of continuing to just pull from the same well. And eventually these stories started to come from the same family. And I just kept writing them. And it felt like a weakness in me as a writer for quite some time. Like, why can't I just, you know, make up new people or new places? Why do they keep having to come from the same family? But still, you know, I valued the short story above all and felt like that's really what I wanted to write. So I just kept writing these short stories one after another. And then eventually, you know, I got an agent, I got some like really, really generous fellowships. As the years passed, I just kept slowly plugging away and working at jobs not related to writing at all. I was working in like outdoor ed. And so I don't know, as I found my way to an agent, like one challenge I think with the book that we can talk about later is that the stories were both too much alike, but not disparate enough. You know, it wasn't just a plain collection, but it wasn't like a really like a fully linked collection, because again, I was not initially thinking of a bigger narrative. I was just writing like kind of like reaching back to my Loyola days. In my Zen classes there, I was just like chopping the wood and carrying the water. That's how I think of it. But at any rate, one of the stories from the book came from my time in the grad program at Mason. The rest came after, but they still are from, I was drawing from the same well.
And it certainly, like, it took me a while to realize it wasn't a straight novel as I was reading it. So it
That's
certainly
interesting.
Has a lot of cohesion. I intentionally like make myself forget the reviews and things I read so that when I'm trying to read a book the first time, I try not to read the flaps right before I read. I try not to go look at anything. So I try to approach it. I'm just going along and like, oh wait, this is stories, I think, that were, so it took me a minute to realize I think these were originally written as stories. Because there is especially it takes a while before you get your first like brand new separate character. So, and I was like, okay, I feel comfortable now saying novel and stories, but I was not sure when I was starting out. So that was interesting to hear that. So just curiosity for people who maybe are interested in publishing itself, not the way back story, but the immediately before publication, what was your experience leading up to this book becoming a physical thing, this physical thing?
Sure. So not the way back story. Perhaps like talking about putting it together with my agent before we submitted it. Is that a good place to go?
Sounds great.
Sure. So it was one of the biggest challenges was figuring out where the story started, because I had, you know, I have right now the story starts in 1974. And the broader narrative of the book really, I mean, it's about, I think, four generations of Cherokee women, because they're so interconnected to one another. But the broader narrative really focuses on Justine and Renee, the two youngest of those generations. So I had all these stories to talk about, sort through, and the challenge became figuring out how best to tell a bigger story, because it was clear that I was trying to tell a bigger story, or like I wasn't trying to, but I was, you know, that it wasn't my intention initially. And so it became a process of weeding out stories. You know, I have one story that goes as far back as the great grandmother character is in an orphanage as a girl. So, you know, we go back, I don't know, like, you know, maybe 80, 75 years. I have other stories when Justine is younger than she is when we first meet her, and she's 15 when we meet her. So that was the biggest challenge, I think, figuring out what is the most interesting, bigger narrative? What am I most drawn to? And then how do we best tell that story? And a big part of that question was, how do you start it? Because I needed to introduce a place that, you know, most readers aren't going to be familiar with, a culture, a very particular religion, you know, and then a family with all their particular challenges and histories and everything. So I felt like I needed to kind of set all this up in the beginning, which was really a challenge for me, because I'd been writing kind of like, as I said, just like sort of like dipping down the bucket and rolling up the well rope and just writing these stories, you know, like kind of like based on inspiration or a feeling, chasing after a feeling, and a short story comes out of that. And it was a new thing to need to write a story for the purpose of a bigger narrative or a plot even, you know. So that was what the process was like. And it took a long time for my agent, Adam, and I to, he's really good. He's interested in developing. He appreciates and likes literary fiction. So that's really like, you know, that's a good place to start. But so it became a process of seeing what gaps that readers might not be able to go with. And do we need to add a story once I figured out the beginning and things like that. So it was just a process of that took years. You know, I probably worked with Adam for about 5 years. And I think that is much longer than, you know, most people work with an agent for their debut. So, I mean, he's really great and a good reader for my work, thoughtful, patient. I think I got lucky, because I feel like a lot of agents probably would have been like, what are you doing? You know,
that said, it's not the longest like pre-book relationship with an agent I've heard of. I have a couple friends mm-hmm. who are like, do you even have a book? How do you have an agent? Yeah, it's
yeah.
How did you pull this off? So were there any surprises, anything that was particularly exciting, anything that was particularly a slog during the publication or post-publication process?
Oh my God. I felt like a lot was a slog, because filling in those holes in the narrative, like that felt really challenging, because I was being pushed to do something as a writer that was not how it ever worked really. And so I was being pushed to do that, and you know, and so the first story, which I'm really proud of, it took me over, you know, 2 years to get that right. So that's a lot of what I was doing with Adam, was figuring out how to start the book. And that felt like a slog, like, and like the specifics of that. If anyone has read the book, there is a roller coaster component that I think is essential to the story as a short story. But, you know, I was trying to juggle all of these things I mentioned, like place, culture, religion, and family. And I wanted the plot of the story to not necessarily the main plot, but a part of the story is this teenager who's from a very religious family, really wants to go experience a roller coaster. Her church won't allow her to do these kind of quote unquote worldly things. And that was an important part of me understanding the story, the character. But it felt like, I think as I would pass it back to Adam, it felt like I was just trying to juggle too much, you know. Roller coaster, blah, 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 blah. It's like, you know, you start naming them and it's like, yeah, I was juggling a lot. But what, as a writer, what I would hear is not, okay, like, you need to cut the roller coaster. That might have been what was being said, but that's not what I was hearing. What I was hearing is, I need to make it bet, like, it's not working. I've just got to revise it again and make it work. excuse me. So over and over, we would go back and forth. We'd be like, the roller coaster's still here. It's like not working. Okay, I'll keep working. I was completely willing to keep working and revise it and hear that it wasn't there yet. But I just, for some reason, I felt like that was essential to the story as I saw it. And it took over two years of that, you know.
That's a long really time on a roller time. Coaster. That's a long time on a roller coaster.
What a roller coaster, right?
So if someone came to you today and asked, what would be the one thing you'd tell them they should know about the publishing process?
I mean, I think that story exemplifies two things you need to know. And that's one, you need to take feedback and be willing to work and revise until you get it right. And two, you need to know when to listen to whatever your gut, your mind, your heart, wherever it's coming from. Listen to what you feel like is essential. You know, you can't write that out. I mean, you know, and yeah, I think both of those things, they don't have to be opposed to one another at all. They can seem like it, but I don't think that they are if you're willing to work.
That's great. So we're going to turn to some actual questions about words now. But before I start my questions, I do want to mention that if anyone in the audience has questions they'd like to ask, just type them into the chat window. If you're on your computer, you just hover over the bottom and there's a little chat button. And I will keep up with those and ask them periodically throughout, interspersing them with my own questions. So please ask questions as they come to you and I'll be happy to get to as many as possible. So for me, the book is driven so much by character. It's such a great, I mean, there's one of the blurbs I think says this would be taught in creative writing workshops. I think we'll be using this for character studies a lot in terms of teaching creative writing. But novel is driven by the growth and change, sometimes the lack of change of your characters. We revisit many of the characters several times throughout their lives, years pass, and we see the same character at different points. So I guess just how do you compose complicated characters? How much do you plan in advance versus how much do you discover during the process of writing versus how much you mentioned revising, how much of these characters came in a revision process?
Sure. I mean, I think a lot of these characters kind of, you know, they were inspired by, as I said, like who and where I came from. And they kind of came with a set of characteristics and I had to work to give that depth, I think, and complexity and get to know them as characters as time went on. It's really a hard question to answer because when you work on like a book as long as I did, like, geez, I don't even remember. Like this, it's almost like somebody, like a family member. I don't know. They've just always been this way. But, you know, there are certainly other characters who are less, you know, like more just sort of like a creation that I made up. And I think it's through revision. I think a lot for me, like as I'm drafting it, I mentioned it kind of, it feels like chasing a feeling when I'm writing a short story. And that's what I'm doing. And I revise like obsessively at the sentence level. So like every day I start a new draft and start just retyping where I was the day before. So that's one reason that I'm a very slow writer is because so much of, you know, when your day's work is limited, and you're retyping every day, like what you're adding new can be pretty small. But I just revise and in working with the language anew each day, from what was there before, that allows me to be open to changing things and getting to know a character, if that makes sense. Like kind of like the language can guide and surprise me as I'm revising it. And that can certainly be overdone. And I think I've been victim of that as well. But I think that's how I get to know a character is just like retyping obsessive almost, you know, and some days nothing changes and it's just a matter of like exercising my fingers.
This is a question that's related to characters. I'm going to jump in real quick from the chat, which is, can you write about people you know without them knowing getting offended? Do you ever tap into actual real people as you're writing these characters?
So I don't know, like, I feel like different people are going to answer this question really differently. For me, like, I would say no, like that I couldn't do that. And I would want to be upfront if I felt like I was getting a lot of inspiration from a particular person for a character. I feel like I want to be pretty upfront with it. you know, so I let's see the question. Wait, can you repeat the question again? Did I answer it? Am I done?
I mean, can you write about people you know without them knowing and getting offended? So
I don't think so. What do you think, Zach?
I don't know. Whenever I don't like it when I'm writing about something that is actually completely real mm-hmm. in my process. So it doesn't mean I don't draw from it, but if I realize I'm writing something influenced by a character, by a real person, I usually grab another real person and merge them in just to get mm-hmm. away from the single person.
I'm looking
right now has really for the first time elements of things I experience, but they're completely ripped from context and rearranged. And so the mm-hmm. thing that happens in the book is not real. So I try to move away from reality. And one of the ways that, like, this is a lot like that person. Let's mush this other person in.
Right. And,
there is one minor character who I used the guy's real name, and I texted him like, hey man, can I use your name? He's like, yeah, sure. So it's like,
yeah,
this is basically you, but not, you know, I changed his job, but otherwise it's mm-hmm. the same kind of person. And I main characters, I couldn't ever have based on someone. Occasionally I'll throw a nod to a pal by, mm-hmm. One of my friends, he has friends who write Star Wars comics, and they wrote a character who was him. And so he's now like a Star Wars canon character, but like, you know, it's like, what?
It's very cool.
Like, he uses his last name as the character's last name even. So anyway, that's my goal now, is to one day be a Star Wars character.
That's great. Yeah. So I feel like you rung like a bell. I feel like the closer a character may be to someone you know, the greater the responsibility I have to let them know. And, you know, not that they have to necessarily sign off, but just like, you know, the greater responsibility to have like open communication to happen, which you did with your friend, although they were only a minor character. I don't know. It seems like a good way to do it, but it can be hard because as you do change things and make some things up, if people feel like they recognize themselves, but they have this character acting in a manner that they would never act or that doing something they never did, you know, then it gets weird and mushy. So I really, you know, think that's wise to make characters mishmashes of things and people, even if you're getting a strong inspiration for something and someone.
That's why I don't write nonfiction. That's the real answer to that. I have to be able to make it up or I wouldn't be comfortable probably writing it all. A couple more questions about character, then there's some questions coming in the chat I'll turn to. So are there any things you deliberately try to accomplish with characters? Do you have like a goal number one when you're sitting with a character, something you look for to let you know that a character is realized?
Mm-hmm. No, for me, it's much more. I can't think too much, especially in an early drafting kind of creating process, or else I feel like I will paralyze myself. So for me, it's much more kind of mushy and feeling based. I can't really set out with wanting the character to do something until later when I see what they're trying to do. And then I can try to make the story work to support that and push them more in that direction.
Back to the publishing side of things for a minute from the chat questions. I'd like to hear more about how you met and engaged your agent. Did you know you'd need a lot more of his time reading and going back and forth than working on selling it?
I did not know that because initially I was thinking really that I was working on just a story collection. And my agent is my second agent. The first agent I worked with, he was a guy named Will Bogus, who was a really great reader for my work. He grew up in rural North Carolina. But not long after I signed with him, he decided that he wanted to go back to those mountains in North Carolina and leave New York. And I always say that I really hope it wasn't my stories that drove him out of New York, but you never know. But he was really great. And so he sent out an email with a couple of stories to some agents who he thought would be interested in working with me and who he knew wouldn't mind developing a manuscript. Because once we really kind of got in and working together, you know, he noted that something that was happening, as I mentioned, was the stories were both too alike, but too dissimilar, you know, that kind of put them in this weird squishy middle space. not wholly linked, but not wholly different enough. So that so I think if people were reading that collection I had been writing, they would have been looking for connections that were in that might and might have been unsatisfied. So anyway, so he sent a really nice email around, and Adam Eaglin was the only person who was interested in representing me. Some people were interested, but were, you know, pregnant, having a baby and gone, and, you know, different things. But Adam was the only person, and he was ready to sign me like after a quick conversation. And I don't think either of us expected to be working on the book so long together. But I, you know, as I'm a slow writer, and I was also slow to kind of realize a direction for the book. But I'm grateful for the time. It was really, really a wonderful process of having, you know, somebody to work with. I've heard stories that aren't super great working relationships, or maybe people have different visions. But it was pretty great as far as working on your first book with an agent for 5 years can be.
And I mean, and I should say, Dimenzi Shirley, I mean, within the last 2 weeks, there have been a couple of big honors for the book as well. Yeah. So the Publishers Weekly Best Fiction of 2020, and then you were long listed for what is by far the most elegant sounding prize in all of literature, the Carnegie Medal. So congratulations to both those. So point there being that the time has obviously paid off in terms of the final product became a thing that's being received well in so many ways.
Yeah, thank you. And it was like also long listed for the first novel prize from the Center of Fiction.
Oh, that's right. I forgot that one.
Which is like every time somebody calls it a novel, I feel really good because that was, you know, a big challenge as somebody who's just sort of like just wanted to write a story after story, but kept to being cursed by the same character. So it's like, hot damn, you called it a novel. Sweet. Thank you.
So from our own Amy Freeman at the Writer Center, I am a writer of a certain age. I'm also not on a traditional writer-y path. Can you talk more about the challenges or freedoms that gives you?
Sure. I mean, I think for me, I am both, you know, like older than probably the average. I don't even know, but I'm guessing far, far older than the average person who you hear about publishing their first book, right? And I have a young daughter. And so that for me, that's been one of the biggest challenges as far as just finding time to do the work is, you know, when you have young kids, that can be completely take over all of your time. There's not really free time. So that's just kind of the fact of that is challenging as far as what's more freeing. I don't know, maybe I feel more relaxed about like whatever my process is because I've had a lot of time to worry about what my process is or isn't. So I've just had more experience, you know, with the fact that I'm a slow worker and things like that. But I don't, you know, but on the other hand, other people who might start later, it's not that they've been working on a book for 14 years. Maybe it's just that they've, you know, been doing like career stuff or getting kids up from being little kids and older, and now they're able to start. So the paths are all different.
I was, my first book came out at 37. So I was mm-hmm. not a 20 something, whatever, coming out. And I studied, speaking of undergrad, I studied jazz at Loyola. Uh-huh. I didn't study English. I didn't turn to writing until after I graduated. So I didn't have any, like, I'd ask you who your teachers were at Loyola, but I wouldn't know them because I took the core English classes and didn't do anything beyond that with English until after I was done with undergrad. So,
but wait, I know this is probably only interesting for us, but when did you finish there?
2002.
We were there at the same time.
Yeah, we were. I was when you said you had been there 25, like that puts us like contemporary right at the same time. So
we were totally there at the same time.
We're classmates. Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
What's up?
So another question in from the chat was, now that you finished the first book with a not so linear path of pulling it together, mm-hmm. what, if anything, are you doing differently in writing your next project? And what is the next project? That part was me at the end. That was the add-on from me.
Sure. So what I'm doing differently, I'm going to be honest, I don't know. I'm struggling to write during the pandemic. I'm really, really struggling. Part of that is a result of time, and part of it is just sort of where it's, you know, I'm a person who's having a hard time being creative right now. but I have an idea for a novel. I have like just a really rough start, but it feels odd. It might be like a product of trying to write right now. But, you know, before I felt like I had a story, I just was compelled to write. And so I, you know, having to write from an idea is very different. And I don't know how that works. So I feel a little bit like I'm starting all over. And it's not very similar to my experience before.
I mean, I've heard that from lots of writers, like it's every time you write a novel, it's a mm-hmm. brand new thing. You never mm-hmm. learn to write a novel. Every project has its own challenges. I mean, I just speaking personally, like my first book, it sold some copies, but it didn't do particularly well. And in a way I was grateful because it freed me to do whatever the hell I want for mm-hmm. book number two. Like there's no expectation from the next book to match the first book because it didn't sell well enough for me to have a brand that is tying me to that. And so I actually abandoned a project that was the one I was working on that was a little bit more like book novel number one to tackle just a completely different thing. Mm-hmm. So anyway, yes, it's a weird time to write. And anyone who has children, I would support you however I could if I could support you, because I have no idea how anyone with kids in the house is pulling some of this off. So my parent friends, I just wish there was a thing I could do. And we can't even like offer babysitting because of quarantine. No. Like, you know, like I give you a day, but I can't. So.
Yeah, thank you.
I think you answered, you sort of hit that. How, let's say in non-quarantine times for this mm-hmm. question, because I think you answered this question for currently, but how much time in a day or a week do you usually write when things are not what things are now?
Sure. I don't know. Like, I don't think that I have a stat. Like my pattern, like post becoming a mom is that there's not really a pattern. And I, you know, I go through phases of like, I'm going to get up at 4:30 and write and start my day doing that. But then I'm, you know, I'm slow with everything. I want like a good cup of coffee, and I want to like live the dream. So like, first I want a good cup of coffee, and then I want to read a short story before I write, and you know, and like all that time adds up. But again, being a mom, that's challenging. You get up at 4:30, your kid gets up at like 5:30, like invariably. But before I became a mom, I was a person who wrote, like I really had to catch fire. And I might not write every day, even though I think that I should be, but when I would catch fire, I might like sit on like a futon and write for all day long, you know. And my husband would be saying like, do you want to eat? Do you think you should eat kind of thing, which is not really like, usually I'm like the first one lining up with my plate. So I think that for me right now, there is no pattern. I think of myself as an early morning writer, but honestly, when I'm able to find time, often there's kind of like a warm spot in the late afternoon, early evening, when other people are kind of doing things. And it's probably just a result of that's when there's some space when I can slip away with my computer and, you know.
So we have another character question in here. So I think it's just about, it's about crafting character. So what is better, to give a reader an appearance of a character or give an opportunity to a reader to create that from their mind?
That's an interesting question. I was thinking a little bit about this the other day, and I think that you need to give readers something to hang on to so that they can create their own image. I'm not a big, like, I need to describe that her hair looked like this and her eyes look like this. Like, and I think that's in part because as a reader, that's not very interesting to me, but I feel like if you can give readers something that feels more vivid, and, you know, like the inside of her shoe always wore first, you know, like, you know, and that's not really, that's not just like a straightforward description. So I think there's a balance there, I guess. I don't spend a lot of time describing what my characters look like. I'm more interested in what they sound like, honestly.
It depends on the project, because there's certainly a project where you might not have much character description. And also, I think it's just like any detail in that you want a telling detail.
Right.
You don't need to list every detail of a person to describe them, but like, if you know someone, like there's probably one or two things you think of if you had to describe a friend. What are the one or two, ask yourself that question. If I had to describe my friend, what are these two things? If I had to describe this character, what are the two things that would first come to mind? And that way you're not giving a laundry list of physical attributes, you're hitting the major ones. So I think that's a way I've seen. I love descriptions that work that way. That like, I can fill in the rest of the details, but you gave me two really good ones to hold on to.
That's great, yeah.
All right. Please keep the questions coming. I think I am caught up on those right now. So I'm going to turn back to my sheet. So one thing, because in this book, there are so many long gaps between, time gaps between chapters. Sometimes a chapter will, big gaps of time elapse between the chapters that occur. So it requires there be some summary, because we have to be caught up to know suddenly where someone is, how they got there. And I think I don't write summary very well. Whenever I go through my own work, I'm like something, I'll be editing like, this doesn't feel right. You were summarizing again and doing it poorly. Yeah. And for your case, though, I think you're a very strong summary writer. So I really like reading your summaries. And I guess my question is this. First, are you aware as you're writing of this balance between summary and scene? Was that something you were working on maybe in the editorial process with the agent?
I think about it a lot. I do think about it a lot. When I was at Mason, I took a class with Alan Chus on scene making, and he would force us to write completely in scene. And so I do think about it a lot. So anytime I'm going on at any length at all in summary, I'm really aware of it. And I'm like, is this dragging? Is this interesting? Like, is the language doing something like either necessary or interesting, or hopefully both? But I'm very conscious anytime that I'm in summary.
I mean, I feel like summary gets a bad rap because of maybe creative writing workshops.
I think
but,
so.
I read Colson Whitehead's Underground Railroad. Like, once you get to like the latter two thirds of that book, it is 90% written in summary until you get to the church scene, for those who've read it. And then it's back in a scene again. But it's like, this is just beautiful writing that is all summary for like more than half the book. So it's certainly not a thing that can be done. But I noticed it again in yours that you were doing that in that same sort of way. Like I noticed it, but it was just like, oh, this is flowing and beautiful writing. So
yeah. Thank you.
How do you make sure that summary has depth though? Is that something you said you do try to keep it going. How do you try to keep it writing? Is it specific things you look for? Are there red flags you look for of things that look like slowing down too much? Are there techniques that you employ?
One technique I employ is having married a poet who is a really good first reader for my work. And so, you know, I think that's one really good place to have a trusted first reader, somebody you can talk to and get a sense for it, because it's hard for me to know sometimes. There are passages in the book where I've been like, ah, that's just dragging right there. I'm going on too long, I think, you know. And then you get feedback and it's like, no, this is like one of the like best parts of the story. It's like, oh, okay. And I do think that I carry that scene workshop with me like heavy in my head, which I think is a very good thing for me, you know, to try to try to rein myself in at times. I think that was one of those things that's a really good, you know, like basketball, like you practice skills like, you know, 500 layups or something, which is really hard, but then later, like when you're shooting the, I don't know, I'm not going to finish the metaphor, but I think we're there.
Well, I think we have the new greatest advice that we've ever received for writing craft, and it is marry a poet.
It for sure. If you can do that, I'm telling you, man, having a poet in house to read your work once they get to know it is the best.
That's gonna be our new Writer Center motto: marry a poet.
Yeah.
And read poetry. I think I hit on this at least every other craft chat with prose people, is reading poetry is the best thing you can possibly do for your prose.
Mm-hmm.
Read it even if you don't understand it yet. Just keep going through it until the rhythms get in your head and you sort of pick up on how they're doing their thing. A question on genre. Since you talked about the switch you made, I can't seem to find a comfortable home in one genre. Any tips on how to test my writing or my plot or my ideas in genres, or tips on how to find my genre?
I mean, can we ask a follow-up? Like, in terms of like fiction versus nonfiction, or in terms of thrillers versus literary?
Yeah, we'll come back to that one. So please, if you pull that in and get the, let us know what kind of genre. Are you talking about short story versus long form? Are you talking about lit fic versus one of the genre, sci-fi, thriller, mystery, whatever there? And we'll come back to that one in just a moment. So from Amy again, can you please talk about your book title? Your title is fantastic, and I love it because it lets us know the wonderfulness that will await inside once you get there. So,
thanks so much, first of all. And it's not a very interesting answer, because it was just one of those like drop the bucket into the well thing. Like I felt like I was writing a book called Crooked Hallelujah for a long time. I don't know when I first started thinking that. I was open to other titles, and I talked to my agent about some. And just none of them ever felt like the book. And we talked a lot about changing it. There was discussion of it being You Will Miss Me When I Burn. And I was like, no, that doesn't quite feel right. And, you know, what about Will You Miss Me When I Burn? ? And it felt too literal for the ending of the book. I have a folder on my computer saved. You'll Miss Me When I Burn, because I was like, I'll try it for a while, and it just never felt like, you know, felt like it stuck. Like, we have a dog we adopted, and his name is Doc, and his name was Doc from the litter, because there were seven dwarves. He was the Doc, but we gave him a few different names when we brought him home, but we had called him Doc so long waiting to take him home, it just wasn't he wasn't any of those names except for Doc.
I found the title for my novel during research scrawled at the top, and it never left.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it just, like, from before I started writing until publication, it was the same thing and never discussed.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, okay, that was I had the easiest title process ever.
Which one was that?
First Cosmic Velocity. So that's a term, sort of a dated term from cosmonautics, and that's a good phrase. And it's didn't intend to title the book that, but I wrote it at the top once, and it stayed there from handwritten notes to typed to finished product. So,
because it's a really good title.
Thank you. I can't claim coming up with it. I just saw it.
Right.
A found poem. It's a found poem.
Mm-hmm.
So back to the question about genre. They wrote a mystery, but when it sounded too cozy, I tried to thriller it up. Then I was told it was too chick lit. Now I hardly recognize it. So this is also, I think this is a question about genre, but also about how people perceive things and how the market demands certain things.
Yeah, I don't know, because, you know, I wrote a book that didn't really, it was kind of between genres a little bit. And so, like, my advice would be to find like the heart of what you felt like you were not wanting to write, but that you were writing, and work toward that. And then if people, you know, who understand markets and it's their job to do those things, don't like it, like, you have to figure, you know, don't think it doesn't fit somewhere. You have to figure out whether or not you can revise, like one of those roller coaster things. Is it something you can let go of, or is it not? You know, I feel like you can only pay so much attention to what genre it fits in as you're writing. It's what I think, but I'm also a person who feels like I get paralyzed if I set out with something in mind that I want to do. So that, you know, my advice might be very different from someone who says, oh, I have an idea for a book and I'm going to set forth to write it.
I think there is a disservice done by some agents who are specific in their criticism. And because agents have personal preferences, mm-hmm. and they're explaining to you their personal preference. And sometimes that is aligned with sellability, whatever that means in terms of taking a book and selling it. But I mean, I tend to think it's like, write what you want to write, query 50, 100, 200 agents. And only then, if everyone says no, then maybe you come back and go, okay, this isn't a thing that an agent wants. I don't know if this is from an agenting question, mm-hmm. but just I'm thinking of it in terms of agents, because so often they have very specific wants and specific feedback. But and same with publishing a story. I mean, one journal will say, I think this story should have that. The next one says, this is perfect. We're publishing it tomorrow.
Right.
So it's, there are opinions. And I think that's one of the risks. We give the weight of fact to the opinion of someone because they're in it, they're a gatekeeper somehow. Mm-hmm. And they just might not be the right gate. So also trust yourself, I guess is my advice. All that rambling was to say, you can trust yourself a little bit, get back to the thing that you recognize, and then try to find someone who recognizes the same thing in your work that you recognize it in yourself. All right. So let's jump to one thing I want to talk about. Like, you also have just gorgeous language in this book. So I did want to hit language. We're already getting close to the end of time. This has flown by. So I've read a lot of books this year that have a setting in wide open spaces. Lauren Frances Sharma's, we did an event with her. The cat just joined me. So he's going to be my interview partner from now on. Lauren Frances Sharma's Book of the Little Axe has some scenes set in the West and also in a homestead as well. So it's a couple of small isolated kind of settings, but also wide open surroundings. And that wide open surrounding, like there's something, I feel like there's a language thing that goes on there. And I wonder if you could talk about writing wide open spaces and how you achieve through language sort of this scene feeling. How do the scenes feel broad, even when you're not writing, even when you're not using the words, it was a wide open field? How do I know I'm in a scene with a wide open field?
Sure. I do not know, Zach.
Okay.
That's a tough one. I don't know. I mean, when I think about the spaces that were wide open, and I think about the North Texas stories. And so I guess I think about the, like writing about what is out there maybe will reveal how sparse it is, you know, because the Oklahoma stories, they're not really wide open. And those were harder to write because I don't feel like, you know, my time of living there is it's a further reach. But, you know, when I think about writing North Texas rural stories, I think about mesquites and I think about barbed wire fences and I think about sunsets. And I guess all of those things are really evocative of the spaces in between those things, maybe.
That's interesting. How did you feel the setting affecting your use of language? I mean, like, I think a lot about like how what I'm writing about makes me use certain words. And you've written a lot in this setting. Do you feel like yourself, Amy and I were talking at the very beginning when we first pulled up about the fact that she did a find in her document of a word and found out she'd used it three times and didn't realize that. Do you find yourself returning to certain types of language, certain phrases, certain words in particular as you're going through this? Is that a process you have to go through in terms of dealing with language?
I think it's probably something that I should do more. But I, you know, I think that when I'm writing about those open spaces, I do write about sunsets a lot. But it's also kind of a recurring theme. It's something that the characters do together when they don't really have, they don't have much, but that's something that they do. So yeah, I don't know. I think that I probably mention barbed wire and sunsets a lot, maybe more than I should. Larry McMurtry would be proud. I don't know. Not, absolutely not. Maybe not.
Oh, that's a new standard for certain. For yeah. So, did you use a question from Connie? Did you use beta readers, and if so, would you please describe the process you followed and the value to you?
Sure. As I mentioned, I did get lucky and marry a poet. And so Scott is my first reader and my most important reader, really. But even before I will like Scott will read something for me many times, usually before I let it out of the house, to even to my agent or anyone. But before I even let Scott read it, like I like to feel like I've taken something absolutely as far as I can go. Very rarely do I just want to say, hey, what do you think about this? I want to feel like I've done everything I can do with it. And then I want to get feedback. And then I go back and I revise and do everything I can do with it again. And then maybe we go back and forth several times, maybe, you know, and then it goes to Adam, my agent. And, you know, even if it's something that Adam's giving me feedback on, you know, like I'm just really lucky to have like that kind of relationship in-house where we can talk about it and as the process goes. Not very often, but occasionally I'll kind of like throw my hands up in the air if something just isn't working and reach out to other like close friends who are good writers and thoughtful people in general and good readers. So occasionally I'll send something out if I just need another voice, but really I have between, you know, Adam and here in the house, I have the voices that I need in my head.
I'm like you. I want something as done as possible for me before someone else reads it. Mm-hmm. I do have a friend though, Joe, who will like send incredibly early drafts. I'm currently being lit by a light shined off one of his manuscripts that he sent me that I printed out, and I needed some extra light. So I'm shining a light off it for some ambient white. But yeah, so he'll like, I haven't started reading it yet, but he absolutely, like, his process is so different than mine. And it's fascinating that there's not one way to do this. Like, it's like, I would never want to show something in the early stage to someone. I want to figure it all out and then get those final things from them.
Yeah, but I will get like fundamental things. And that's, again, I'm a really slow worker. Like I really try to figure it out. And then maybe I get something, you know, fundamental. I'm like, oh, I didn't even see that. Let's go back and throw it out and start over.
Ugh. I have one last question I did want to try to fit in before we run out of time, which is, so a lot of the chapters you wrote stories, and you wrote, I guess there was some material that was original for the book, but when you were selecting the pre-written stories, which ones you're going to include, how much did you have to revise those stories to make them fit within the larger structure, or did they just sort of get plugged straight in and work right away?
Very little, because again, I felt completely like faithful to the short story. And I really do feel like a short story is something like once it reaches its ideal form, whatever the ideal form for that short story is, you know, any kind of tinkering like can throw it all out of whack. And to me, like it just might not work anymore. So anything that I changed was very intentional, even if it was minor, like, hey, we already know this character now that we're reading these together in a book, you know? So I didn't change a lot of the existing stories once I put them in, because I felt like they were, you know, it's so different. A chapter and a story do such different work, you know?
I mean, I would have believed you anything you told me there if you'd spent months revising things to make them all tie together, because it does fit so seamlessly all the way through. So, and I guess my final question is asking for some advice for our guest here. What is one piece of advice you'd offer to a writer just starting out on a book length project?
I would say find your, I talked about like those evening hours. For me, it can be my surprising warm hours, like to write. Find what your warm hours to write are. And try to set yourself up a routine, despite the fact that I've said I am struggling with that. Did you say one piece of advice?
Yeah, as many as you want, just keep going.
Okay. Find a good reader for your work. You know, you got to find a person who's going to read it and be critical and who's going to be thoughtful about it. Like, don't be afraid to revise, you know, maybe like your process isn't going to be revising obsessively like I do, like restarting every morning, like retyping the same thing I wrote yesterday. But just understand that is the work, and that is writing. It's just like letting the story tell you what it's about and working to get it there. I feel like that's so much of our job, is like like a sculptor, like, you know, you have a piece of something and you've just got to chip away until you discover what's there. And then you understand what your work is.
love the sculpting metaphor. So thank you for that. Mm-hmm. So the last thing I'm going to say is, everyone, please go buy copies of the book. If you haven't read it already, please buy the books. I see Amy is busily copying and pasting the bylink back into the chat window. So please look at that. I apologize we didn't quite hit all our questions, but I hope we hit most of them. So Kelly, thank you so, so much for joining us. This has been great. We hope you will remain a friend of the Writer Center and that we'll see you at things in the future for future books.
Thank you so much, Zach. It's good to talk to you. And thanks for all of you for coming by. It's really, really nice to join your community. So thanks for having me.